Jesus, the Missing Years, by Walter Parks. Read by Alex Hyde-White. Chapter 1. Introduction. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. John 8:32. Over 2,000 years ago, in a land of historical turmoil, a baby boy was born. It was the beginning of the greatest story of all time. He was the baby Jesus. We are taught that he was the Son of God that took true human form here on earth. He started his human life as a helpless baby. He began to understand that he should be about his father's business when he was 12 years old, but he was not ready to start his ministry until he was in his 30s. How did he progress in his human life from the helpless baby to the world's most worshipped God? What was he thinking during this progression? How did he deal with his human emotions, his early childhood doubts? He had to have emotions and doubts, or he would not have been human. And the Bible tells us that God sent Jesus to live among us as a human. What preparations did Jesus need to get ready for his ministry? Where did he make these preparations? Why does the Bible not tell us where he was when he made these preparations? Why does the Bible not address any of these questions, and why does the Bible not even mention him or his activities for the 20 years prior to his ministry? Jesus is very important to us. We need to have the answers. We need to know the truth. It is my belief that the truth is always out there. You just have to find it. I searched the Bible, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Nag Hammadi codices, and other ancient documents for clues to the truth. I studied the writings of the ancient historians and philosophers, Flavius Josephus of the Jews, Philo the Jew of Alexandria, Egypt, Pliny the Elder of Rome, Hippolytus of Rome, Dio Chrysostom of Greece, and others. I could not find absolutely conclusive written answers to all the questions. I continued looking. Then, using the evidence that I did find, I began to consider and analyze the likely actions of the people around the young Jesus, the actions that the Bible does tell us about. I even tried to imagine the evolving thoughts of the young human Jesus himself. Then it all began to come together. I believe I found the fundamental truth. Let us review the available evidence, my analytical suppositions, and my conclusions to see if you too arrive at similar conclusions. We will start with what we know of his birth. The birth of Jesus. The Bible tells us that Jesus was born in the small town of Bethlehem. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Matthew 2:1. Saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." Matthew 2:2. Luke gives us additional detail in that he tells us that Jesus was born in a stable and placed in a manger. And they, the shepherds, came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Luke 2:16. The birth of the Messiah in Bethlehem had been prophesied. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. Micah 5:2. So the Bible tells us that Jesus was born according to the prophecies of old, and perhaps just as importantly, that he was born on earth as a human baby. The fact that he was a human that led a human life is very important for two reasons. It makes us realize that he could better understand us and our needs than could an abstract spiritual God, and it tells us that he would have special needs to transition from a human baby to the Messiah and to our God. Date of Jesus' birth. Tradition holds that Jesus was born in 0 AD, as set by a monk in the 6th century AD, when he attempted to divide all the time between the time before Jesus and the time after the birth of Jesus. But it appears that the monk made an error in stating the year of his birth. The Bible tells us that Herod reigned when Jesus was born, and from other records we know that Herod reigned from 37 BC to 4 BC. This has caused many scholars to therefore say that Jesus was born in 4 BC. The Jewish historian Josephus, however, tells us that an eclipse of the moon occurred not long before Herod's death. Science shows us that such an eclipse occurred from the 12th to the 13th of March in 4 BC. Thus, Herod must have died about April of 4 BC. Further, the Bible tells us that Herod searched for the newborn children for 2 years to kill them before his death. This indicates that Jesus was born no later than about April of 6 BC. When there was no scientific evidence for the appearance of the Star of Bethlehem, an argument developed that the Star of Bethlehem may have been based on astrology rather than astronomy. Astrology shows that a most favorable time for a king to have been born would have been in April of 6 BC. Some scholars therefore believe that Jesus was born in April of 6 BC. But the Bible tells us that the star was actually seen, saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." Matthew 2:2. What could they have seen? The only star that would have been bright enough to qualify for their descriptions of the Star of Bethlehem would be the conjunction of the planets Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn in the constellation of Pisces. This occurred in the spring of 7 BC and is the only heavenly event with any scientific proof that can be found to have been bright enough to be the Star of Bethlehem. The Star of Bethlehem was the conjunction of three planets. That conjunction of the planets was preordained by the laws of physics, the laws of nature, the laws of God. God did indeed make a portentous announcement for the arrival of his Son on earth. The Bible tells us that when Jesus was born, the shepherds had their stock out in the fields at night. This suggests that Jesus was born in the spring, summer, or fall, rather than the winter. The stock would typically have been brought inside in the cold of winter. This coincides with the spring date for the Star of Bethlehem, and thus the time of year for the birth of Jesus. However, a monk in the 4th century A.D. set December 25th as Jesus' birthday because it was the date that year of the popular pagan feast that celebrates the winter solstice, typically December 22nd. Apparently, the monk wanted this long-established and most important festival to be attributed to Jesus. He knew that the pagans would continue to celebrate their festival and that setting Jesus' birthday at the time of this festival would help them to become aware of and to remember Jesus. The visit and adoration of the Magi was studied to provide additional clues to the date of the birth of Jesus. There are several biblical references in both Old and New Testaments. The Magi followed the Star of Bethlehem. "There came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him.'" Matthew 2:1. "The kings of Tarshish and of the isles shall bring presents. The kings of Sheba and Seba shall offer gifts. Yea, all kings shall fall down before him." Psalm 72:10-11. We know from non-biblical evidence that the Magi were a sacred caste of priests from Persia. They had survived through the ups and downs caused by the Assyrian and Babylonian powers and through the repression in their own country of Persia by King Cyrus and his son Cambyses. At the time of Jesus, they were still flourishing under the Parthian rule. The Magi wise men were believed to have been experts in both astrology and the prophecies. Old prophecies had told of the coming of a king of the Jews, and they followed the Star of Bethlehem searching for Jesus. They were probably followers of Zoroaster, the ancient Persian religious leader, who may have been the first to believe in one God. Some scholars believe that there is evidence that the Magi may have searched for Jesus for almost 2 years. Since there is no biblical record for the precise birthday of Jesus, the author has considered all of the most reliable evidence and has concluded that Jesus' birth was indeed heralded by the Star of Bethlehem and that he was born in March or April of 7 BC. Jesus as a baby. In addition to the birth of Jesus, the Bible and tradition tells us of seven additional events in the life of the baby Jesus. The adoration by the shepherds, as described by Luke, the circumcision, as described by Luke, the adoration by the Magi, as described by Matthew, the flight into Egypt, as described by both Matthew and Luke, the slaughter of the innocents, as described by Matthew, the purification of the virgin, as described by Luke, the return to Nazareth, as described by both Matthew and Luke. There's been a great deal of controversy about the precise sequence of these events. There is no need, however, to argue that detail here, because these events in his life are already so well known, and because the sequence of the events does not provide additional insight into the primary subject of this book. These events are only mentioned here for two reasons. They tell us that the birth of Jesus happened under circumstances and in the place that had been prophesied in the ancient Jewish texts. The prophecies had told us that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem and that he would live in Nazareth. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Matthew 2:1. And he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. Matthew 2:23. We have found him, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. John 1:45. For lo, thou shalt conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come on his head. For the child shall be a Nazarite unto God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. Judges 13:15. So, what? The importance of this from the standpoint of this book is that the Bible tells us that Jesus was born a helpless human baby. Jesus as a boy. The Bible summarizes the next several years of the life of Jesus. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Luke 2:40. The next event in his life that is described in the Bible is when he is 12 years old and his family goes to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. Luke 2:42. The Bible tells us that when Mary and Joseph left Jerusalem, that Jesus stayed behind. When they realized that Jesus was not with them, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. Luke 2:46. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. Luke 2:47. There is only one more mention of Jesus as a child. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and man. Luke 2:52. Storytelling approach. Jesus is not mentioned again in the Bible until many years later when he begins his ministry. We must therefore look to other sources of information to learn where he was and what he was doing before he began his ministry. And also important is our desire to learn why the Bible does not tell us where he was and what he was doing during this formative period of his human life. What could have been the reason to leave out this extremely important phase of his life? Scattered information can be pieced together to provide us with his activities during this previously lost period. Such information, however, does not cover the day-to-day chronology of his activities. In writing this book, I had to choose one of two paths: present the available facts and let the reader struggle with the gaps in information, or enhance the story with supposition that fills in the blanks to provide a complete story. I chose the latter for two reasons. It presents an easier-to-understand story, and it retains the first option in that the available facts can clearly be distinguished enough from the supposition that the reader can draw his own conclusions. Another issue in telling the story is one of style. Based on the evidence found, it seemed appropriate to write some of the story from the personal viewpoint of Jesus himself. These, of course, are supposition on my part, but let's explore it. What was the human Jesus thinking? And when did he think what? How did his human instincts and religious understandings evolve from those of a human baby to the Messiah, to God on earth? When did he understand that he was indeed the Messiah? It is not likely that he knew when he was a human baby, only one day old, nor would he have likely understood when he was a human baby of 1 year old. When would he have begun to understand? We know from the Bible that when he was 12 years old, he had developed his understanding enough to make the following statement to Mary when they came to the temple searching for him. "How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business?" Luke 2:49. It is from this point that we begin the story. Jesus, the missing years. You will likely agree with at least some of my observations and conclusions. You may disagree with others. And there will be some that you essentially agree with, but would prefer to make modifications. Agree, disagree, be wishy-washy, prefer to modify. You may experience a wide range of emotions. In any event, you will begin to realize what you personally believe about Jesus. You will certainly come to know him better. Carpe diem.
Chapter 2. Jesus in the Temple. I must be about my Father's business. Luke 2:49. Solomon started building his temple in about 960 BC. It took him 7 years. Nebuchadnezzar, king of the Babylonians, completely destroyed Solomon's original temple in 586 BC and took the Jews into captivity. Not a trace of Solomon's original temple exists today. Cyrus, king of Persia, conquered Babylon in 539 BC and allowed the Jews to return to their homeland in 538 BC. The second temple is built and finished in 515 BC. The Seleucids took Palestine in 200 BC, and then in 170 BC they erected an altar to their god Zeus in the temple. King Herod began to dismantle that temple in 20 BC to build it bigger. He finished most of his work in about 1.5 years. However, some work continued long after his death in 4 AD. The temple was not completed until 63 AD. The temple did not last long. The Romans destroyed the temple in 70 AD. It was in the King Herod rebuilt temple that the boy Jesus met with the doctors and rabbis as stated in the Bible. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. Luke 2:47. The Bible tells us that Jesus was in the temple for 3 days while Mary and Joseph had accidentally left him behind. We only know that he was in the temple listening, asking questions, and giving answers. We do not know what specific issues were discussed. We do not know what he ate during those 3 days or where he slept. Who cared for this 12-year-old human boy? Let us imagine the depth of awe that the Bible tells us the doctors and rabbis felt as they witnessed the young Jesus listening and asking questions. Let us imagine what Jesus himself was thinking. We know that at this point Jesus had already understood that he should be about his Father's business. We know from his being a young human boy that he would have to go through a transition to evolve to the Messiah. How and where did he go through such a metamorphosis? Here he is in the temple among the most learned religious leaders of his day. He has the best chance of his young life to ask questions and understand the best of all available teachings from these great thinkers. He therefore takes the opportunity to ask all the questions that have been formulating in his mind as he has been struggling to understand his own internal transition from a human baby to the Messiah. we can imagine a torrent of questions from the young boy. And in response, we can imagine deep questioning from the rabbis and others present. How could this boy have the wisdom and understanding to ask such questions? How does he grasp the answer so quickly and so completely? Where did he get the information to answer some of the questions put to him from the rabbis? Mary had surely told Jesus of her messages regarding his birth and destiny. Jesus would certainly have felt that he was to be a man of destiny. He would have already experienced some years of searching for the path to that destiny. Here was the door to that destiny. Jesus looks about the great temple and wonders, "Is this really the house of God? Does God really live here, as the Jewish religion of the day taught?" Jesus feels God within himself, not just in the building. Jesus knows that God will go with him when he leaves the building. So what does it mean to say that this is the place where God lives? Such fundamental questioning within himself and to the rabbis goes far beyond the typical questions that the rabbis normally address. Jesus tells them that he is here to begin to be about my Father's business. The rabbis question the young Jesus as to what his Father's business may be. How does Jesus answer? How aware at this point is he of any of the real details of his destiny? The rabbis ask Jesus where his parents may be. He tells them of his mother Mary. What does he tell them of Joseph? They ask where he lives. He tells them he is from Nazareth. Nazareth. He shall be called a Nazarene. Matthew 2:23. We have found this man to be the leader of the sect of Nazarenes. Acts 24:5. The rabbis knew that Nazareth and the nearby Mount Carmel area were the locations of the largest of many Essene communities. All of the rabbis had strong feelings about the Essenes. Some hated them because they had broken away from the temple and were no longer under their control. Most, however, admired them because the Essenes lived strictly by the laws of Moses. The great Jewish historian Pliny the Elder summarized the way people thought of the Essenes. "They are a people unique of its kind and admirable beyond all others in the whole world." Pliny the Elder. The Essenes themselves believed that they were the elite among the Jews, and they believed that the Messiah would be a Nazarene and that his coming was near. So this boy is from Nazareth. At least some of the rabbis would begin to question themselves about this special boy. Could he be the prophesied Messiah? At the very least, he was a gifted child. We can imagine that some of the rabbis would have conferred with each other about who this boy may be and what they should do regarding him. It was likely that an elder rabbi took the initiative to pull the boy aside, perhaps at mealtime, to question his background and to learn more about his parents. He would have learned that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. The Messiah was to have been born in Bethlehem. Jesus was from Nazareth. The Essenes said the Messiah would be from Nazareth. Jesus was from a poor family. The Messiah would be from a poor family. Jesus said he was there to be about his Father's business. From such conversations, we can imagine the elder rabbi becoming more and more interested in this young boy. We can see him inviting Jesus to share his meals and to spend the 3 nights at his home. Wouldn't you? We can see the elder rabbi's interest in Jesus growing to almost an obsession. The elder rabbi would recognize that Jesus, being the age of 12 years, should be starting his formal education. The rabbi would have realized that because Jesus' family was poor, that they would not be able to provide the best available education, the kind of education that this boy definitely deserved. We can understand that the elder rabbi would, just as you and I would, want to get involved in the future of the young Jesus. After 3 days with Jesus, the elder rabbi and Jesus would likely have developed rapport with deep respect and trust for each other. Therefore, when Mary and Joseph returned for Jesus, we could imagine lengthy conversations before they departed. What would the elder rabbi have asked? What would you ask? What
would Mary and Joseph? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.